Chapter 6, Bones and Skeletal Tissues, Part 1. So, the skeletal system has many functions. It protects and supports organs of the body, including the brain, the heart, the lungs. It provides a rigid framework for the body, giving it its shape and allowing the muscles to pull on those rigid structures to allow for movement. It stores minerals, especially calcium, which is very important for our body. It produces all blood cells. So, all blood cells are produced in the red bone marrow. And energy storage. The yellow bone marrow is made of adipose tissue, so is storing triglycerides, fatty substances. Hyaline and fibrocartilage are also important in our skeleton. Cartilages, as we know, have little pockets called lacuna. Within the pockets are the cells, the chondrocytes, and then this material surrounding the lacuna is the matrix, and that can include collagen fibers to help give the cartilage strength. We can find the cartilage in a lot of different areas in the skeletal system. So for instance, hyaline cartilage is found on the smooth surfaces of bones that form joints. So those smooth surfaces have articular cartilage on them. There's the costal cartilage made of hyaline cartilage attaching the ribs to the sternum. The fibrocartilage is also found in a few places, the meniscus in the knee, the pubic symphysis, a thick piece of fibrocartilage attaching the two hip bones, the intervertebral discs, all big thick pieces of fibrocartilage. The purposes of the cartilage is to provide a smooth surface, so at joints, a nice smooth surface to reduce friction. The cartilage can also resist compressive forces, so for instance, in the vertebral column, our vertebra don't hit each other if we sit down really hard, because of the fibrocartilage discs. And another feature is they are avascular. There are no blood vessels in cartilage. So that means cartilage heals really slowly when damaged. Again, locations of hyaline cartilage, the articular cartilage at the ends of the long bones, the costal cartilage connecting the ribs to the sternum, and the fibrocartilage, the intervertebral discs, the menisci in the knee, the pubic symphysis. All right, moving on to bone tissue. Bone tissue is mostly extracellular material, and that extracellular material is 35% organic, which is the collagen fibers. And collagen fibers give the bone tissue its flexibility and tensile strength, making it very strong, able to resist forces. And then the other 65% is inorganic material, primarily calcium phosphate. This minerals give the bones their hardness. As we also can see in compact bone tissue, it has little pockets called lacuna. These little dark spots are the lacuna. It has a large spaces called the central canals where blood vessels and nerves are found. And then lamella are these layers of tissue. So we have these layers of tissues in a ring structure in this case. It would be called lamella. There are four main kinds of bones. Cells. There's the osteoprogenitor cells. These are stem cells. Osteoprogenitor cells will divide to form osteoblasts. Osteoblasts are the cells in the bone tissue that deposit bone tissue. They build up the bone by making more extracellular material that then becomes calcified. So osteoblasts build up the bone tissue. When osteoblasts get surrounded by bone tissue and trapped in lacuna, they differentiate and become osteocytes. Osteocytes, their function is to maintain healthy bone tissue. So they keep it healthy and they alert the bones when there's stresses in areas. The fourth cell comes from a different lineage. Fourth cell is called the osteoclasts. Osteoclasts reabsorb the bone material, so they break down the extracellular matrix, break down bone tissue. When they do that, they release calcium into the bloodstream. We could think of them as cutting or cleaving the bone tissue. Different kinds of bones. We have long bones. Long bones are much greater in length than width. They always have this middle structure called a diaphysis or shaft. Examples, most of the bones in the arms and hands and most of the bones in the legs and feet are long bones. Short bones. Short bones are vaguely somewhat cubic, so about as wide as they are tall as they are deep. Kind of. They are found especially in the carpals or the wrist, the tarsals, and the ankle and the patella. These are all short bones. There are flat bones. Flat bones are very thin, the layer of compact bone tissues on the outside and then the spongy bone tissue in the middle. Flat bones include the sternum, the ribs, and many of the bones of the skull. And then irregular bones. Irregular bones, like the vertebra, have complicated shapes, so they don't fit in the other three categories very well. Examples include the vertebra and the hip bones, also the sacrum and coccyx. All right, there are many bone surface markings, and we'll be learning the names of some of them. But first, I'm going to break them down into general categories. One big category is depressions and openings. So for instance, fissure. Fissure is a very narrow, wide slit or opening between bones or within a bone. They're providing a passageway for nerves, blood vessels, muscles to pass through. There are foramen. Foramen are smaller openings going through a bone. They are, again, passageways. They are holes letting blood vessels or nerves pass through the bone. A fossa is a depression, a shallow depression, an indention into the bone surface. Usually they're there to fit another structure. So in this case, these fossas on the humerus are making space for the ulna and radius when we completely bend the elbow, flex at the elbow. Sulcus. Sulcus is a furrow, a groove along the surface of the bone. Again, this is providing a space for some structure. In this case, often tendons or ligaments, sometimes blood vessels or nerves. There are the processes that form joints. So these are the processes that come together to form joints, also known as articulations. One example is condyles. Condyles are smooth, rounded knobs at the ends of bones. Facets. Facets are smooth, flat surfaces or slightly curved surfaces where bones come together to form joints. And heads. Heads are large, smooth, rounded knobs or that project out to help form joints. Usually what follows the head is the neck. So again, these are all smooth surfaces because we don't want any rough friction-generating surfaces at joints. We want it to be smooth movement at these articulations. All right, we also have, though, rough structures. These rough structures are attachment points for tendons and ligaments. A crest is a large ridge that is very rough. It's a very elongated process that is an attachment site. We have epicondyles. Epicondyles are rough projections above condyles. Again, a place for tendons and ligaments to attach. A spine. A spine is a very thin, sharp projection sticking out. Again, very rough so that muscles can attach to it. Tuberosity is a large, variable sized rough patch on a bone, sometimes really thick, sometimes not that obvious. Those are tuberosities. All right, moving on to the anatomy of a long bone. We can dissect the long bone and find a variety of structures. So for instance, what you might call the shaft, the middle region of the long bone, is officially known as the diaphysis. Long cylindrical, made primarily of compact bone tissue. Within the diaphysis is a cavity or space called the medullary cavity. This is where we house yellow bone marrow. And would you expect to find yellow bone marrow in the frontal bone? Of course not. It isn't in the long bone. All right, at the ends of the bones, proximal and distal, these ends of the bones are called the epiphyses. So proximal epiphysis and distal epiphysis. The epiphyses have compact bone tissue on the superficial layer. So there's outer compact bone tissue forming the epiphysis. And then inside it is the spongy bone material. Lots of branching out of the bone tissue and lots of spaces that are filled with blood vessels, nerves, and red bone marrow. So we find red bone marrow in the epiphyses. Also, the epiphyses have smooth areas. These smooth areas are where joints are formed. And that's also where we find articular cartilage. Also found in epiphyses is, in adults, epiphyseal line, calcified structure. In children, it's called the epiphyseal plate, and it's made of cartilage. So for children, epiphyseal plate, which is the growth plate. In adults, epiphyseal line, which is calcified, and adults' bones no longer grow in length. Again, at the smooth ends of the epiphyses, we have articular cartilage, hyaline cartilage, that helps to reduce friction and absorb shocks at the joints. Surrounding the rest of the outside of the bone is connective tissue structure called the periosteum. It holds blood vessels and nerves, helps to hold them next to the bone. Also, we find osteogenesis cells, osteoblasts, osteoclasts. Endosteum. Endosteum is on the inside, lining the inside of the medullary cavity, lining all these little nooks and crannies of the spongy bone. It is just like the periosteum, but by surprise, on the inside of the long bone. All right, here's a close-up of some compact bone tissue. As you can see, there's these little circular, concentric circular ring structures. Here's one, there's one over here. These reoccurring ring-like structures are called osteons. So compact bone tissue has lots and lots of osteons. Here's a close-up of an osteon. We see in the center is a space called the central canal. This is where we find blood vessels and nerves. Each layer, each concentric ring of the osteon is a lamella. Within the lamella, we find these little pockets. These little pockets are the lacuna, where we find the osteocytes. And then there's these teeny tiny little faint lines. These are little canals connecting to the central canal so that nutrients can diffuse to the osteocytes and waste can diffuse out of the osteocytes back into the bloodstream. And these little canals are called the canaliculi. One canaliculus, many canaliculi, and connecting the osteocytes and the lacuna to the central canal. Here is a model that we have in lab. Central canal, blood vessels and nerves. Each layer is a lamina. The pockets are the lacuna. Osteocytes, the angry eyes, live in the lacuna. And the little faint lines are the canaliculi. Spongy bone tissue is obviously formed differently. It has all these girders that stretch out and interconnect with each other and with the compact bone tissue on the outside. And these little girders are called trabeculae. So spongy bone tissue is made up of many, many trabeculae. When you look at the histology of spongy bone tissue, you still find lamella, so layers of bone tissue, the lamella. You still see the lacuna where the osteocytes live and the little caniculi. But there are no osteons, no central canal, no osteon. And this is because the girders, the trabeculae, are thin enough that they can get everything they need from the blood vessels that are intertwined around the trabeculae. And here is our bone wedge model. On the outside is the periosteum. On the inside, the endosteum. Here is the trabeculae of spongy bone. Most of this is compact bone tissue, though, with the osteons, osteon, 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 the central canals in the center running the length of the bone. We also have perforating canals. These are openings carrying blood vessels along the width, the perforating canal width, central canals length. We can see the little layers or lamella. All right, bone formation. So we start off when we're an embryo with embryonic tissue. And it is sort of where the bones will be. Some of the tissue goes through the process of intramembranous ossification. Other goes through endochondrial ossification by first forming a hyaline cartilage model. So intramembranous ossification occurs in the flat bones of the skull. Flat bones of the skull. Starts off with a big sheet of embryonic connective tissue, and there'll be many, many tiny ossification centers that will develop where the tissue becomes calcified, where osteoblasts start laying down the bone tissue. Osteoblasts will spread out, forming more bone tissue. Within the tissue forming, there will be a lacuna where osteocytes will develop. The calcified bone tissue will continue to spread through the sheet, getting bigger and bigger. And eventually, it'll all interconnect, giving us spongy bone tissue with the trabeculae. Blood vessels will get incorporated, nerves will get incorporated. And then eventually, the sheets of spongy bone tissue will develop compact bone tissue on the outside, surround the spongy bone tissue, and also a periosteum will form. That's the process of intramembranous ossification for the bones of the skull, and that's going to be the end of part one.